We continue following the Lewis and Clark route. Today going to St. Louis, Missouri. By land, by boat, and by air. There will be a great meetup. We'll look for that perfect view of the arch at sunset, which happens to be right next to the Gateway Geyser, the tallest fountain in the United States. We will also visit the Cathedral Basilica of St. Louis. And finally, the actual Gateway Arch. We'll eat some of the delicious barbecue St. Louis is so famous for. And then on the next episode next week, we'll visit some of the historic sites around the area.
I'm riding,
riding, riding,
riding in my RV,
my RV,
wherever I want to be, 'cause I'm free in my RV, yeah.
To St. Louis we go, it is official, just finished dumping and getting some fresh water, and a new stage of the trip begins. After an uneventful 3-hour drive across the land of Lincoln, we are finally arriving in St. Louis and the gateway to the west. We're going to spend 4 days here exploring and looking for some of the Lewis and Clark historic sites along the way. Just like we did back in 2016, we're staying at the Casino Queen RV Park in East St. Louis. Although, I must say, last time we were here we got a much better sight. These are tiny and there's no clear view of the arch, but hey, we're basically just coming back here to work and sleep, so it is going to be fine. We're going to cook some sausage we got in Kentucky, and we're gonna chop an onion, as I usually do. And look at all that delicious pork fat. Some frozen peppers, garbanzo beans, and take a wild guess. Well, paprika, of course. Salt, oregano, a little bit of cumin. Vino secco, or dry cooking wine. Some hot sauce made by Mark from Dunnellon. I mean, he gave us like a gallon of that delicious stuff. And we're gonna call it a modified Spanish-style garbanzo frito. Very much modified, just in case any of my Spanish ancestors are watching from the afterlife and tossing in their grave. Viewers Leland and Christine have organized a meetup for tonight, and she's also going to be our designated driver. And on the way to the brewery, they're going to give us a quick tour of the city, especially a neighborhood called The Hill, known for its Italian markets and restaurants. Unfortunately, we already ate, but let me tell you, we might try and come back to The Hill before we continue on the journey west.
Gonna have a meetup tonight.
Well, here we go. Cheers.
Cheers.
Here we are at the Great Missouri, St. Louis, Missouri. Although we have people from Illinois as well. So, having a great time here at Rockwell Beer Company. And, thank you all for coming. Great to see you. And we're getting a lot of tips of places to visit too.
Even though we didn't get like the biggest turnout ever, I think a great time was had by all.
Well, as expected, we closed down the place almost. That's how we do it.
Thanks again, Leland and Christine. Till we meet again. I want to take a break from editing here to thank Bright Cellars for sponsoring this episode. And from the first time I found out about Bright Cellars, I thought it was a brilliant idea. You know, especially in order to discover new wines you probably wouldn't even consider otherwise. And learn about this fascinating world in an exciting way. You don't have to go to the store. They deliver right to your door. And all you have to do is a quick 7-question quiz. And they match you with wines from all over the world, curated to your taste palette. Each box comes with these wine education cards for each bottle, and they outline the tasting notes, suggested pairings, best serving temperatures, and origins. And now they also offer members exclusive wine wisdom lessons. All right, let's see what we got this time around, which, by the way, the packaging is completely recyclable, plastic-free, and the smallest carbon footprint in the industry. All right, folk table. I've had this before, so they must know that I like it. Obscura, Petit Verdot from California. We got a white, and this is Forever Filling White Wine Blend. Hold fast, Avasi Wines, 2021 Sauvignon Blanc from Valle Central, that's Chile. Colombia Valley Cabernet Franc, Stone Lantern. And last but not least, Dancing Juice Cabernet Sauvignon from Chile. I think this is the one I'm gonna have today. Let's give it a taste test. That's really good. Let's see what it says. This fruity Cabernet Sauvignon dances with flavors of blue and dark fruits. Subtle tannins and tobacco notes underscore ripe plum, blueberry, and spicy white pepper flavors. Medium-bodied red, 55 to 60 degrees Fahrenheit, so we should chill it just a tad more before drinking the rest. And it's a new world from a moderate climate from Chile. And it even has a QR code so you can scan it and fine-tune your future selections. Sponsors like Bright Cellars make it possible for me to keep making all this content. So supporting Bright Cellars is, in a sense, supporting my channel. So I want to thank Bright Cellars for giving you, my followers, a limited time offer, 50% off their first 6-bottle box. Click the link in the description to get started. Salute. Today we're going to spend the whole day exploring, and we're going to start by going to the Gateway Arch. Not to go to the top, we have reservations for the day after tomorrow actually. Today we're going to start by taking a cruise on the Mississippi River. We've never actually done that. At least not on the Mississippi. I think it is going to be a day of firsts. We're driving south, on Broadway. Pretty nice condos here, actually. And here on the left is the historic courthouse, where former slave Dred Scott sued for his freedom. It is nowadays a museum. On the right here, Ballpark Village, with a bunch of restaurants and entertainment. We visited back in 2016 and we'll come back for dinner before we go. And of course, Busch Stadium, home of the St. Louis Cardinals Major League Baseball team. I don't know, it seems we may have taken a wrong turn. Lots of seemingly abandoned buildings in this area. But we're following the instructions, and the river seems to be up ahead. Let's make a left here at this mural. It seems to be in that general direction. Alright, it is $10 flat rate, so let's do it! And it is a dead end. Okay, let's park on the other side. It seems to be free today. At least there is no one collecting any money. I think this is supposed to be buses only, but there's nowhere else to park. And I doubt very much they are going to tow away all these people, so monkey see, monkey do. And here we park. It is certainly impressive. Well, here we are, we've made it to the Gateway Arch right here, but that's not what we're gonna do right now. We actually have a reservation for a riverboat cruise, so we're gonna do that first.
I think, actually, the arch we're gonna do like tomorrow. They didn't have tickets for today.
The boat is called Tom Sawyer. That's just perfect. They have a small cafeteria, but for now we're just gonna find a good spot on the top deck so we can have a good view and look at all that driftwood coming downstream. Our sister boat is called Becky Thatcher, Tom Sawyer's love interest. How appropriate!
Everybody's ready for the horns, here we go!
As I suspected, the paddles are just for looks.
We got a lot of what we call driftwood logs, complete trees, you name it, coming down the river. That's because the river has been rising over the last several days. Now it pretty much crested, it peaked out yesterday. It's slowly starting to fall, but we still have a bunch of potential firewood coming down the river.
Here's another great view of the iconic courthouse. As we zoom out, we see it perfectly framed by the arch. The cruise, by the way, very informative, and our captain is a great guide, inserting anecdotes here and there, historical facts about the buildings and the bridges we're navigating under. Apparently, that used to be the site of a great floating casino, and this old power plant nowadays provides steam to heat some of the downtown buildings. Then comes the time to talk about the barges and the sheer amount of cargo that goes up and down this river. I should have recorded the whole tour because the information is quite fascinating. All kinds of cargo gets loaded onto these barges. As we go under the I-70 bridge, it is time to turn around.
Change speed, please be aware of that. Hang on to your hats, anything that might blow over the side. Other than that, sit back, relax, and I'll be back with you in just a few minutes.
This old abandoned building seems very historic, formerly the Cotton Belt Freight Depot. The Migrate mural from 2014 has since been partially covered by graffiti, and the building is home to several unofficial tenants. It is definitely a city of contrasts, where urban blight can coexist with the world's tallest arch, actually one of the most impressive structures ever built. The Mississippi River itself is a river of contrast as well. When we compare the beautiful skyline with the industrial side of the river, which may not look as attractive, but is necessary for commerce.
On position, we have a southbound tow coming down the river. I mentioned that this tow that's now behind us at about the 5 o'clock position, who is waiting for southbound traffic to clear the area. Well, here comes the southbound traffic at about the 1 o'clock position. Looks like he has 15 loaded barges, and all that will carry a few thousand gallons of lube oil, motor oil. And those two black round tanks on deck would have been full of drinking water, fresh water, potable water. And the small barge will tie up alongside the big tow boat as the big tow boat continues to move up the river. Hoses will be put across, and the big tow boat will get fuel and water and lube oil while it continues to move up river.
It must be an interesting lifestyle, living aboard one of those tow boats, pushing cargo up and down this great river. And we're almost back.
Everybody's ready for the horn. Here we go.
Look what the river has dragged down. Very, very sad. Actually, this might be a good opportunity to clean it up, don't you think? I didn't realize the Gateway Arch is now a national park. A Clydesdale, perhaps?
Here we are, this is surreal being here. And you probably can't tell, you know, you have no depth perception in the video, but it's quite surreal to be here looking at it from this vantage point. Now we're gonna go up the steps to the bottom of it. All this was under construction the last time we came, so this is really cool to be here. And we're getting good weather today. Tomorrow we're going to the top, but tomorrow might rain, so. But tomorrow may rain, so I'll follow the sun.
Tomorrow, or actually most likely the day after, we're going all the way up there.
Well, I wonder what happened there. Drone, perhaps? I hope they have insurance.
We decided on a whim to do something we had never done before, and that is go on a helicopter ride. It is not a cheap tour if you count dollars per minute, but I think the experience is definitely worth it. It is something you have to do at least once, right? And the unthinkable happened. The GoPro malfunctioned. Luckily, I was also filming with the Sony, so not all was lost. Down below, we can clearly see the Anheuser-Busch Brewery. We're not gonna visit this time around. We did the tour back in 2016, and let me tell you, it was great. So I'm definitely gonna put a link to that video somewhere. Now we're flying over the Missouri Botanical Garden. We can see the Rose Garden and the Glass Dome, which is actually a geodesic dome greenhouse. It is called Climatron. It houses a rainforest, and right next to it we have the Temperate House. Now coming up, the Japanese Garden, with a lake, islands, traditional bridges. From this vantage point we can even see the colorful fish. So cool to be able to see all this from a higher perspective. The structure next to the Ferris wheel is the St. Louis Aquarium, housed at what used to be the St. Louis Union Station. And there's a Hilton too, so hopefully we'll get to visit sometime. Someday. And we are already heading back to downtown. Let me tell you, time really flies when you're flying. Now flying over Busch Stadium, again, home to the St. Louis Cardinals. As we see, once again, the iconic view of the Gateway Arch, I sense our helicopter adventure is coming to an end. There's Minitini 3 somewhere down there. We'll be right back. Here we have a sculpture, and this one is called The Captain's Return. It was commissioned in 2006 to mark the bicentennial of the end of the Lewis and Clark expedition. It shows the triumphant return of William Clark and Meriwether Lewis and his dog Seaman to St. Louis. And the Gateway Geyser seems to be erupting. It is actually the tallest fountain in the USA, and we'll see it up close later on, maybe tomorrow.
Yeah, GoPro is the most unreliable thing ever, but here we go, here we are, right underneath the Gateway Arch. Now let's continue.
Well, at this point we're more than a little hungry, and what is St. Louis famous for? Barbecue, of course, and we're going to go to what up until now has been the most famous place. If you're thinking Pappy's, that's exactly where we're going.
Efficient. They have outside tables here, and that's where we're gonna do it. Pappy's Smokehouse. Not the most beautiful presentation, but it was efficient. Let's eat.
This is one of those rare occasions in which I'm going to break the timeline. For the rest of the day and tomorrow, we're going to visit some of the Lewis and Clark historic sites and other attractions outside of town, but I'm going to save those for the next episode. Right now, we're going to time travel 2 days into the future to Tuesday, June 7th, 2022, and see the rest of St. Louis, at least what we get to see. But first, the sunset. So we came to Malcolm Martin Memorial Park, to the Mississippi River Overlook, just to see the sunset. I wonder what's going on there. In any case, here's Malcolm overlooking the sunset. It's a brand new day, and our last full day here in St. Louis. First of all, it is almost noon, so we're going back to that vantage point from where we saw the sunset, because it is at noon that they fire up the Gateway Geyser, and I want to see it up close. Here's Casino Queen and the Cargill Grain Elevator. As you can see, it has a conveyor belt to load all those barges. And here to the left is that Mississippi River Overlook. We're gonna make a left and park.
There it is, once again.
Yeah, that view of the arch, it never gets old. Here we have some information about the geyser. On a calm day, like today, the geyser will match the height of the Gateway Arch at 600 feet. I guess they are just teasing us right now with the four smaller fountains, which, by the way, represent the four rivers that converge nearby. The Mississippi, Missouri, Illinois, and Merrimack. And they just fired up that big generator. Or maybe that is the pump itself. there are three 800 horsepower pumps that power the geyser. The Swiss-designed nozzle itself seems to be what makes the fountain so special. It aerates and gives a true shimmering whiteness to the water. It is the tallest fountain in the United States and second tallest in the world as of 2022. It almost reminds me of Yosemite Falls, the way the water comes back down from the top.
Well, we finally get to see the Gateway Arch geyser here. And on a day like today with no wind, the geyser reaches an altitude as high as the arch itself.
We've got more than one mode of transportation present here. It is certainly impressive. It only runs for about 10 minutes every day at noon, weather permitting, and I was hoping for a little better weather perhaps, in the form of blue skies, but hey, we'll take it. And just like that, it is gone.
Well, the day before yesterday we came at sunset, you know, to see the sunset. Today we're coming during the daytime to see it from a different same vantage point, just different light.
I think, besides the view from the actual river, or the chopper actually, this has got to be hands down the best view to be had of the arch. And there's a barge coming. Even better. By the way, they have a webcam, and of course we took a screenshot of that.
It's one barge after the other coming up river. And here we have Malcolm, enjoying the view for eternity. Let me tell you something, timing is everything. Look what's coming this way. All those people coming this way now.
Once again, we're spending a good portion of the day visiting some of the more iconic spots on the Lewis and Clark Trail, and as I mentioned, we're going to save those for the next episode, so we can focus more on the city of St. Louis, which is, as I mentioned, a city of contrasts. A lot of it is beautiful and prosperous, like these parts, and then there's all these areas with abandoned buildings, high crime, which we could visit too, but I prefer to focus on the pretty parts, like King's Highway Boulevard here, for example. The imposing Art Deco building is the Park Plaza Tower, and the modern-looking building after it is called 100 Above the Park Apartments. That is luxury city living right here across the street from Forest Park. The main reason we're driving around this ritzy part of town? No, we're not looking for a luxury condo. We actually went to see the Cathedral Basilica of St. Louis. Several people at the Meetup recommended it, and we can see it right there on the left. It is an impressive building, so let's find parking and see if we can go inside. I'm pretty sure we're illegally parked, so we'll be brief. Huge apartment building right in front of the cathedral. Thank you. The St. Louis Cathedral, as it is also known, was built to replace a previous church located along the Mississippi River. It was dedicated October 18, 1914. The church is known for its large mosaic installation, which is one of the largest in the Western Hemisphere, and for its burial crypts. Installation of the mosaics was not completed until 1988, and it is actually considered the largest mosaic collection in the world outside Russia. Since we're kind of pressed for time, we're not gonna visit the museum they have in the basement, but hey, another excuse to return. St. Louis is kind of at a crossroads, so we're likely to come back soon. For now, we'll just admire this lavishly decorated cathedral.
Well, that was very impressive. Now let's go to the arch.
Yes, the moment you've all been waiting for, and the fitting end to our time here in St. Louis. Let's visit the Gateway Arch. There it is, just a short walk away. Let's go into the recently expanded and renovated Underground Visitor Center, which was under construction the last time we were here. It is a beautiful facility. You can tell the National Park Service spared no expense. There's an app with all the major rivers, I presume. Let's go down to the lower level. This is very nice. Before getting to the elevators, you go through the museum, so let's do that first. Yeah, as I said, they spared no expense, and it is larger than I expected. There's a section for every aspect and every time period when it comes to the rich history of this area. The center of the Mississippian culture, the domain of the Cahokia people, the Osage. Then the French came, and the Spanish. That's when the village of St. Louis was founded, in 1764. Eventually, after the Louisiana Purchase, it became part of the United States. They also have a section about the construction of the arch, which was quite the feat of engineering. Soon we're gonna get on one of those tiny little capsules.
It's been a while since I had to wear one of these. Cookie, espresso, water with Jefferson, I mean.
It is time for our 6 p.m. reservation. At least they keep us entertained while we wait for the tram. Of course, I hit my head. The tram is a one-of-a-kind invention, a combination of the elevator principle and the Ferris wheel principle. We begin almost like a regular elevator, moving upwards, nearly vertically. In fact, there's another regular elevator that goes up to the 372 height, more than halfway to the top. But as we get higher, we start gradually going in a more slanted curve until by the time we get to the top, we're going not quite horizontally, but definitely more than 45 degrees. It takes roughly 4 minutes to get to the top, and here we are.
Come out of your trams, turn to your left, and come up the stairs.
There's our casino, but we can't really see Minitini from here. Wouldn't it be cool if the geyser went off right now? One thing that always surprises me is the lack of traffic in St. Louis. I mean, it is 6 p.m. on a Tuesday. I would expect it to be bumper to bumper, but nope. It would probably be really cool to watch a baseball game from here. And what goes up must go down.
I'm trying not to hit my head now.
These were all the monuments proposed at the time. I'm really glad they went with the arch. Let's see a little more of the museum. I mean, we still haven't found the Lewis and Clark section. There's gotta be one, right? Of course, it all began with the Louisiana Purchase. Overnight, the United States more than doubled in size, and it was the event that really initiated the rapid expansion to the West. Crossing the Continental Divide. We are still a few episodes away from that. Check it out, the keelboat. One of the instruments they use to figure out their latitude and longitude. The GPS coordinates, if you will. They took the best chronometers and compasses available at the time. Still, it wasn't an easy task to determine your position on the planet, but essential in order to produce accurate maps, what came to be the first maps of the American West. As we explore this part of the museum, I can't help but wonder what we will encounter along the route. A as we follow the journey of the Lewis and Clark expedition, which, as I mentioned, in this episode I decided to cover the more touristy parts of St. Louis, if you will, but on the next one we will visit everything related to Lewis and Clark, and more.
Here we are, the Ohio River, the Mississippi, and then the Missouri. Sailing to the west, into the sunset.
We still have a long way to go. Well, this was a great experience. I'm really glad we got to do it. And now we came to Kinner Plaza, because from here you can see another iconic view of the old courthouse framed by the arch. You'll see in a moment.
And it is from this unique vantage point that we're gonna say goodbye to St. Louis for now, until we return. As always, thank you so much for watching, and see you on the road, which tomorrow will take us west.
I'm of course lying, because we're starving and I think we can find room for one more famous St. Louis barbecue place before we go. There's a statue of Dred and Harriet Scott, the enslaved African Americans who unsuccessfully sued for their freedom at this very courthouse, one of the events that eventually galvanized the country and triggered the Civil War. We're going to the Ballpark Village, to this joint called Salt and Smoke. How appropriate!
Oh, look at that! We met our goal. Oh, barbecue, beer, and bourbon. Sounds like my kind of place.
Good IPAs, good barbecue, sluggish service, but hey, this place was packed on a Tuesday evening. Now we can properly say goodbye to St. Louis, but only for this episode, because on the next one we'll visit Camp Du Bois, where Lewis and Clark spent the winter of 1803 to 1804 preparing for the historic expedition. We'll visit the Confluence Tower, from where you can see the confluence of the Missouri and the Mississippi rivers, not to mention downtown St. Louis almost 15 miles away. We'll climb to the top of Monk's Mound in the Cahokia Mounds, from where you can also see the iconic downtown. We'll backtrack to Chester, home of Popeye and another Lewis and Clark historic site, the old Cahokia Courthouse and Fort Kaskaskia. What's left of it? We'll pay our respects at William Clark's final resting place. Also, St. Charles, Missouri's first capital. And Jefferson City, Missouri's present-day capital. So be sure to come back next week for the conclusion as we continue following the Lewis and Clark expedition, visiting the historic sites, but also other points of interest and tourist destinations along the way. See you on the road!
Riding in my RV.